Tantor Audio, a division of recorded books, presents The Life and Death of Ella, Grand Duchess of Russia, A Romanov Tragedy, by Christopher Warwick, narrated by Julian Elfer. Author's Note. In writing this biography of Grand Duchess Elisabeth Feodorovna, it was always my intention that it should be a personal study, very much her story. That is to say, I wanted it to focus on Ella and her life, rather than involve too detailed a discussion of, for example, the wars and politics of her time. Nor, I should add, did I intend Ella's youngest sister Alex, otherwise the Empress Alexandra Feodorovna, her husband, the Emperor Nicholas II, and their family, to play more of a part than was strictly necessary. A great deal has already been and continues to be published about them, and I have worked on the assumption that most listeners of this book will already know something about the lives and fate of Nicholas and Alexandra. If not, perhaps this study might whet their appetite. On the way, without wishing to sound patronizing or high-handed, I have tried, in the interests of accuracy, to correct some of the popular myths, misconceptions and errors about Ella, and also about her husband, Grand Duke Serge Alexandrovich, that have appeared in previous books about the Romanovs and, as a consequence, on any number of websites. As so often happens, an unchallenged story repeated often enough, unfortunately, if inevitably, becomes accepted as fact. Russian dating system, names and titles. Before moving on, I should offer an explanation about dates where the Russian calendar is concerned. Until February 1918, when it changed to the Gregorian calendar, in use elsewhere in Europe, Russia still used the Julian calendar, which meant that in the 17th century Russia's dating system was 10 days behind Europe, in the 19th century 12 days behind, and in the 20th century, at least until the start of 1918, 13 days behind. Where known, I have chosen to indicate both Old Style, OS, and New Style, NS dates. Lest I should be accused of inconsistency, I have deliberately used anglicized spellings for names such as Alexander, spelt A-L-E-X-A-N-D-R, instead of A-L-E-K-S-A-N-D-R, but I have otherwise chosen to use Russian spellings elsewhere, a matter of personal preference. Where it appears, I have also used the spelling of Ella's given name, that is to say, Elizabeth, spelt E-L-I-S-A-B-E-T-H, as opposed to E-L-I-Z-A-B-E-T-H. The titles Emperor and Tsar, like Empress and Tsarina, are both correct and are interchangeable. I have used both styles. Similarly, while the literal interpretation of Grand Duke and Grand Duchess is Grand Prince and Grand Princess, I have chosen to use the former more familiar and easily recognized form. 1. Queen Victoria was nothing if not an inveterate choreographer of dynastic alliances. Yet, when it came to choosing a husband for her second daughter Alice, she was not in search of a prestigious match. As she put it, someone good and kind, someone with a comfortable position, would do extremely well for her high-spirited, pert, and even at times willful 16-year-old daughter. What she did not want for Alice was a husband whose duties and responsibilities would prevent them from making frequent and often lengthy visits home, as was the case with her eldest daughter Vicky, the Princess Royal, and her husband, the future German Emperor, Crown Prince Frederick William of Prussia. The Queen always liked to have a man about the house, and if that man was also family, so much the better. Thus it was in 1858 that Queen Victoria turned her sights on the small, albeit far from wealthy, German Grand Duchy of Hesse, and by Rhine, which, until 1806, had been called Hesse-Darmstadt, the name by which it is still frequently, though incorrectly, known. Ruled by the childless and vaguely eccentric Grand Duke Louis III, the Queen's interest lay in his eldest nephews, Ludwig, or Louis, and Heinrich, Henry. Sons of the Grand Duke's brother and heir apparent, Prince Karl, Charles, and his wife, Princess Elisabeth of Prussia, Louis had been born in September 1837. By the time he and Henry were invited to England in the summer of 1860 to stay with Queen Victoria and Prince Albert, first at Buckingham Palace and then at Windsor for Ascot races, Louis was 23, a good-looking young man with a fresh, open face, light brown hair, and, as the Queen noted approvingly, an attractive figure. A certain initial shyness added to his appeal. If the Queen was considerably taken with Prince Louis of Hesse, Alice herself was totally smitten. Cupid's arrow had hit the desired spot with such speed and precision that Louis had instantly become the only man she ever did, shall, can, or will love. Reciprocated feelings led to their engagement on the last day of November. Parliament sanctioned a £6,000 civil list annuity, as well as a £30,000 dowry for the bride-to-be, and Victoria and Albert invited the young prince to stay on and spend Christmas at Windsor, a memorable occasion, not least because of the weather. Not since the reign of Alice's great-grandfather, George III, half a century earlier, had it been quite so cold, with the Thames below the castle frozen solid and the surrounding parkland engulfed in a freezing white mist. Louis's first experience of Christmas with the Queen and Prince Albert would, as it turned out, be the last the 41-year-old sovereign and her beloved 41-year-old consort would have together. Indeed, the mood of celebration at Alice and Louis's betrothal would soon be soured, for with the new year came the blight of death. The first, at Frogmore House, in the private home park at Windsor, on the 16th of March, 1861, was that of Alice's grandmother, Victoria Mary, Duchess of Kent. For the past 2 years, the Duchess had suffered from repeated attacks of erysipelas, an inflammatory disease marked by a bright redness of the skin, and in early March, surgery for an abscess in her right arm had been necessary. As the Queen herself noted in her journal, the surgeon should go to the marrow to see dear Mama's arm. A brief respite followed the Duchess of Kent's operation, but then a turn for the worse brought Victoria and Albert hurrying back to Windsor from London, arriving at 8 o'clock in the evening. At 9:30 the following morning, the Duchess died, her hand in that of her daughter. Sobbing loudly, Prince Albert carried the desolate Queen from her mother's bedroom, and summoning Alice, instructed her, "Comfort Mama." At the end of that same year, comforting Mama gathered even greater urgency for Princess Alice, the angel in the house, as she became known, when the prince consort himself fell ill at Windsor and on the 14th of December died from typhoid. Instead of blaming the castle's drainage system and a profound, life-sapping weariness for her husband's early death, the Queen blamed their son and heir, Albert Edward, Prince of Wales, known to the family as Bertie. Had his father, who was already unwell, not had to make a special journey to Cambridge, where the prince was studying, to reprimand him for his wayward and libidinous lifestyle, a constant where Bertie was concerned, she, and as she learned from the tributes paid to him, the entire nation, would not now be in mourning for he who always led, as she put it, the lily of a blameless life. Princess Alice, who had been born at Buckingham Palace on the 25th of April, 1843, was always extremely fond of her eldest brother and shared with him a strong and lasting bond of friendship. In some ways, she was rather like him. A young woman who knew her own mind, Alice also shared with her father a progressive and modern outlook. That extended to her not wishing to be fettered by the customs, traditions, and protocol of royalty. Indeed, it is easy to imagine Alice attempting to shake free the bonds of convention. From childhood on, she was always anxious to help others and to do whatever she could for them. She particularly enjoyed seeing how ordinary people lived, not least on her parents' Balmoral estate in the Highlands of Scotland, where she visited the crofters in their homes and much preferred to sit with the general worshippers in church than find herself penned up in the royal pew. Not for nothing would the progressive-minded princess one day express the opinion, "I dare say royalty is nonsense, and it may be better if it is swept away." Yet, little could she have imagined what the effect of sweeping royalty away would one day have on members of her very own family, and how it would seal the fate of two of her daughters in particular. For now, however, at Windsor in December 1861, the broken-hearted 18-year-old princess was not concerned with the merits or otherwise of royalty, or in any official sense the loss of a royal prince, but the death at 42 of the father, friend, and mentor she adored. Neither was she, in complete selflessness, at the side of a queen, comforting and protecting, so much as supporting her devastated mother, whose entire world had collapsed around her. With a maturity beyond her years, Alice took control. calling for a sedative to help calm her mother, moving her own bed next to that of the Queen so as to be by her side, responsive to her every tear and restless move, and becoming the conduit through whom all communication was conveyed, whether from family, household, or government minister. In keeping with the tradition of the time that women did not attend funerals, Queen Victoria was not present at that of the Prince Consort, which took place in St George's Chapel, Windsor Castle. Bertie, Prince of Wales, was there as chief mourner, as were his brothers, Affy, otherwise Prince Alfred, future Duke of Edinburgh and Coburg, and the 11-year-old Prince Arthur, future Duke of Connaught. Prince Albert's brother, Ernst of Saxe-Coburg-Gotha, attended, as did Alice's fiancé, Louis of Hesse, whose tears the press noted appreciatively. Louis had also been there when, on the 19th of December, 5 days after the Prince Consort's death, the Queen had walked in the gardens at Frogmore with the purpose of choosing the site for the mausoleum in which Albert, and in time she herself, would finally be interred. Having made her choice, near the lake and close by the circular, single-domed mausoleum that would house the remains of her mother, Queen Victoria reluctantly heeded the advice of her doctors that she should get away from Windsor. That afternoon she left for Osborne, the Italianate-style mansion she and Albert had built overlooking the sea at East Cowes on the Isle of Wight. It was there, as at Balmoral and Windsor, once Victoria had begun what was to become a traditional progress between her houses, that Alice continued to put her mother's welfare above her own. A slim, petite young woman, with an English rose complexion, long, slim nose, soft blue eyes, and a sweet smile that was often remarked upon, the princess had in her own uncomplaining grief become thinner, paler, and more drawn, something Prince Louis noticed with concern when he returned from Darmstadt after an absence of only 2 months. Just as worrying was the possibility that his marriage to Alice might be indefinitely postponed, now that she was nursemaid, companion, and comforter to her widowed mother. Constantly by her side, Alice took her to visit the team of artisans already at work on the innumerable memorials to Prince Albert that the Queen ordered to be made, and took her for drives around the Osborne estate in the Sardinian pony carriage, which, because it was equipped with rubber tyres, ran smoothly and did not add to the Queen's incessant headaches. As E.F. Benson would one day write, Princess Alice made herself responsible for all immediate arrangements, and most difficult of all, she managed to reach, by the mere force of love and sympathy, that stricken heart. She devoted herself, body and soul, to her mother. While Alice's devotion to her mother was beyond all doubt, indeed at the time of the Duchess of Kent's death she had honoured her father's sacred request to cherish the Queen to the fullest extent of her weak powers, Queen Victoria herself would write callously, "The children are good and loving, but I do not find their company the same, and it is no support." As the first wave of raw grief began to subside, Queen Victoria rallied sufficiently to direct that everything he, the Prince Consort, had planned or wished for should come to fruition. That included the marriage of Princess Alice and Prince Louis of Hesse, and by Rhine. Postponed by the death of Prince Albert, it was further overshadowed in May 1862 by that of Louis's aunt, Grand Duchess Matilda, wife of Grand Duke Louis III. "The angel of death still follows us," Queen Victoria observed when news of the Grand Duchess's death was received, adding, "And so now Alice's marriage will be even more gloomy." To the Queen's evident satisfaction, the December mood of Albert's death lingered on through the following summer, so that when it took place on Tuesday, 1st of July 1862, Alice's wedding was, as the Queen wrote to her daughter Vicky in Berlin, more like a funeral than a wedding. Yet if the ceremony itself was to be a private affair, held behind closed doors, Londoners did at least get to see, or, since he had become quite a celebrity, read about Princess Alice's bridegroom. In London, just 6 days before the wedding, he and his brother, Prince Henry, had been caught up in a number of events, including visits to the International Exhibition, the Royal Agricultural Society's annual show, and being welcomed to town by the Prince of Wales in Battersea Park. Then, at the weekend, it was off to solemn Osborne, where Alice and Louis were to be married not in church, not even in nearby St Mildred's, Whippingham, where Alice's youngest sister Beatrice would one day marry, but in the ground-floor dining room overlooking Prince Albert's Italian garden. With a little improvisation and a good deal of noise, as carpenters set to work, the dining room, which the Queen visited to see how the workmen were progressing, was turned into a temporary chapel which, when completed, bore a vague resemblance to the Chapel Royal at St James's Palace, where she and Albert had exchanged their own vows 22 years earlier. Just for a few hours on that grey and blustery day, the black of full mourning would be relieved by the semi-mourning tones of grey or violet worn by the female guests, including the ladies of the household, but excluding the Queen herself, who would wear black for the rest of her life. Princess Alice would, of course, wear the crinoline wedding dress of white honiton lace, trimmed with orange blossom that her father had designed for her, together with a veil of matching lace and a bridal wreath of pearls, orange blossom and sprigs of myrtle. But her trousseau would otherwise revert to the relentless shade of mourning. When at last 1 o'clock, the hour of the wedding, approached, Queen Victoria took her place, shielded from prying eyes by two of her sons, Bertie and Affy, who, as the Queen wrote afterwards, sobbed dreadfully all through. The family guests, who included Louis's parents, Prince and Princess Charles of Hesse, Victoria's son-in-law Fritz, Crown Prince of Prussia, her half-sister, Princess Feodora of Hohenlohe, the Grand Duchess of Mecklenburg-Strelitz, and her sister, Princess Mary Adelaide of Cambridge, cousins of the Queen, were then shown in. Then came the bridegroom and his brother, and finally, conducted by the Lord Chamberlain and accompanied by her uncle Ernst of Saxe-Coburg-Gotha, who was to give her away, a calm and dignified Princess Alice entered the room. Following her, instead of 8 bridesmaids as originally planned, were 4, her sisters Helena, Louis and Beatrice, who at 5 was young enough to find excitement in the occasion, and Louis's only sister, Anna of Hesse. All wore dresses of sprigged net over white satin trimmed with mauve ribbon. Above the altar, with its gold plate and flickering candles, hung Winterhalter's portrait of the royal family, painted in 1846. Victoria and Albert, formally dressed and seated on a pair of George IV's impressive gilded chairs, set on a colourful Persian carpet, are seen with 5 of the 9 children they would eventually have. Included in the group is the dark-haired Princess Alice in gold-sashed cream satin, who at the age of 3 is shown with her elder sister Vicky and the infant Princess Helena, frilled, beribboned, and lying on ermine-lined red velvet, mirroring the draped canopy over her enthroned parents' heads. Next to this family group, at which Queen Victoria, fighting to control her emotions, stared fixedly, her gaze never leaving the figure of her late husband, hung another portrait by Winterhalter, a reminder of another loss, another reminder of days gone by. Of the Queen's mother, portrayed in feather-trimmed bonnet and shawl, this study had also been painted in 1846. 3 years later, it was one of the gifts the Duchess of Kent gave to her daughter for her 30th birthday. At the close of this most cheerless of royal weddings, conducted by a highly emotional Archbishop of York, assisted by the Dean of Windsor and the local rector, the royal guests made their way to the council chamber, where a wedding breakfast was to be had, albeit in the absence of the newly married couple, while their suites of attendants were served at déjeuner in a marquee on the lawn. Bride and groom, meanwhile, repaired to the small ground-floor horn room, so-called because its furnishings were made from the antlers of deer shot by Prince Albert. There, notwithstanding the lack of a wedding cake for the young couple to cut, they ate and wept privately with the Queen. Later that afternoon, Alice and Louis left Osborne for a 3-day honeymoon not far away at St. Clair Spring Vale, a castellated mansion near Ryde. There, despite the presence of numerous servants, 2 gentlemen attendants, 1 lady-in-waiting, and the arrival of Queen Victoria, who invited herself to tea on the second afternoon, the prince and princess were happily alone and, like any loving honeymoon couple, free to enjoy themselves. When all too soon they returned to Osborne, the Queen, who had already elevated Prince Louis from his Hessian rank of Grand Ducal Highness to the style and dignity of Royal Highness, now conferred on him the Order of the Garter, England's oldest and most prestigious order of chivalry. 4 days later, and 1 week after they married, came the inevitable highly emotional farewell as Alice and Louis set sail from Osborne aboard the royal yacht Victoria and Albert. Bound for Antwerp, this was the first stage of their journey across Europe, en route to the Grand Duchy, over which they would one day rule. Despite encouraging words and promises of returning to England in the very near future, it was an especially difficult leave-taking for Alice, so much so that she had hardly had time to remove her bonnet before she sat down to write a note to her mother. A few lines she wrote, "To wish you once more goodbye, and to thank you again and again for all your kindness to us. My heart was very full when I took leave of you, and all the dear ones at home. I had not the courage to say a word, but your loving heart understands what I felt." Victoria's heart was not, it transpired, as loving or at least willing or capable of understanding any feelings but her own. Despite her daughter's selfless devotion, the Queen, who so very definitely turned mourning into an art, coldly observed, "I hardly miss her at all, or felt her going, so utterly absorbed am I by that one dreadful loss." By contrast, the reception Alice and Louis received when, during the late afternoon of the 12th of July, they arrived in Darmstadt, a once medieval city lying to the extreme right of the Rhine Valley at the foot of the Odenwald Hills, was nothing short of ecstatic. Accompanied by a mounted escort, they rode in an open carriage drawn by six horses through streets bedecked with flags and triumphal arches. Church bells pealed, flowers were showered on them like confetti, and cheering crowds lined their route through the city centre to Bessungen, a southern suburb made up of cobbled streets and pitched roofed houses, literally just outside town, which was finally incorporated into the city of Darmstadt in 1888. There, occupying a corner site at number 3334 Wilhelminastraße, stood the Palais Prinz Karl, a large, if architecturally unremarkable house that opened directly onto the street. As its name indicated, this was the residence of Prince and Princess Charles, and until their own house, which would be known as the Neues Palais, was built nearby, part of it, an annex, would act as Louis and Alice's first married home. The downside of this arrangement, as Alice told her mother, was that the rooms, though prettily arranged with such perfect taste, all by my own dear Louis, were very small. Coupled with the noise of everyday traffic clattering over the cobbles directly outside her windows, it was a very far cry from the parks and estates of Windsor, Balmoral and Osborne that Alice had known all her life. Nevertheless, it was something that the princess, young and very much in love, felt she could cope with, and the warmth of the reception she and Louis had just received from the townsfolk had touched her very deeply. It was, she wrote home to Queen Victoria, all so kind, so loyal, I believe the people never gave so hearty a welcome. While Alice, who would always remain first and foremost a British princess, was determined to make herself at home in Darmstadt, trying earnestly and cheerfully to do my duty in my new life, and to do all that is right, which is but doing what dear Papa would have wished, it wasn't long before some of the traditions and etiquette of the Grand Ducal Court began to irritate. One ritual was Grand Duke Louis's practice of hosting Sunday dinners for his family at one or other of the dozen lodges and shooting boxes that he owned around the countryside. Princess Alice disliked these obligatory get-togethers not only because they bored her, but because a 4:30 dinner put paid to more intimate family Sundays she preferred to spend with her husband and in time their children at home. Another reason for her disdain was that she didn't always care for the meerschaum smoking, toweringly tall Grand Duke who, at 6 feet 10 inches, had once been upright and very handsome. The man Alice knew had become stooped and grossly overweight. Now bald, he had what remained of his hair tightly curled on either side of his head, a task that required the full-time attention of one of the three brothers, Fleck, who attended him as personal servants. Neither did Princess Alice like some of the Grand Duke's more curious ways, especially his eccentric repertoire of grimaces, which he thought amusing, but which served only to terrify his young nephews and nieces and disgust Alice herself. When she first arrived in Darmstadt, there was already an established routine to daily life, the pattern of which did indeed include taking meals at very odd hours. Writing to Queen Victoria little more than a week after her arrival, Princess Alice described her day. "We usually get up about 7:15 and take some coffee at 8. Then we either go out till 10 or remain at home. Until 12 I write and arrange what I have to do. At 1, when we return from breakfast, we usually read together. I have still a great many people to see and they usually come at 2. At 4 is dinner, and at 5:30 we are usually back here and occupy ourselves till 6 or 7, then drive out somewhere for tea at 8, walk about, and return at 10:15. Again, it was the idea of dinner at 4 in the afternoon, always in formal evening dress and always consisting of several courses, followed by tea at the ludicrous hour of 8 in the evening, that Alice railed against. Although Grand Duke Louis III was not at all impressed, the princess, who was still only 19 years old, put her foot down and insisted that, in her own home at least, dinner would be served at 2 p.m. with tea at the traditional late afternoon tea time hour. If this sort of thing left the princess open to criticism among Darmstadt hardliners, members of the Grand Ducal family gradually came to understand how different was the court in which Alice had grown up when compared to their own smaller, poorer, and more provincial realm. Princess Marie of Battenberg, one of Prince Louis's first cousins, recalled, "In our circle, but little was known in those days of England and English customs, of its luxury and practical, solid enjoyment of life, and it was a long while before the really very great difference between the modest little house in Darmstadt and the castle in Windsor was appreciated." Although looked upon as a foreigner, the young Princess Alice was nevertheless someone who greatly appealed to her Hessian in-laws. Writing to his only sister, the Empress Marie Alexandrovna, wife of the Russian Tsar Alexander II, Louis's uncle, Prince Alexander of Hesse, said, "I think you would like Alice. She is a funny little woman, full of charm, very cultured and very talented." To Prince Alexander's daughter Marie, Alice was a most attractive and arresting personality. "Her voice particularly, and her pretty mouth, with its even teeth, aroused my admiration, as did her clothes, which had a distinctive and to me an unfamiliar style." It was the strength of Princess Alice's character that would ultimately leave its mark on Darmstadt, an influence that continues to be felt within the former Grand Duchy to this day. Yet if in those early days her free-thinking, pioneering spirit meant she wasn't universally popular, she was at least secure in the love of her husband. "You tell me to speak to you of my happiness, our happiness," Alice wrote to her mother. "If I say I love my dear husband, that is scarcely enough. It is a love and esteem which increases daily, hourly, which he also shows to me by such consideration, such tender, loving ways. There is such blessed peace being at his side, being his wife. There is such a feeling of security, and we two have a world of our own when we are together, which nothing can intrude upon." It was, however, a marriage of opposites. Prince Louis was easygoing and good-natured, unintellectual and unpretentious. He was a man who preferred a simple, uncomplicated life. He disliked arguments and, insofar as possible, refused to allow people or situations to upset him. He was also a man who valued friendship, not least those that, as a committed soldier, he had established while serving with the 1st Regiment of Guards at Potsdam. Beyond family life and soldiering, Louis's chief interest was hunting, mountain cock and deer in Upper Hesse and Rombrod, in summer and autumn, and wild boar in winter. Princess Alice, on the other hand, was a very different character. Although by nature volatile, Louis himself was somewhat in awe of her temper, Alice, like her father, lacked a sense of humour. Yet for all that, she was also cultured, artistic, intellectual, and religious. Darmstadt's cultural tradition particularly appealed to her, and under her influence, it was to flourish yet more brightly. Reflecting her own love of music, she delighted in the fact that Brahms came to the house to play the piano with her, the opera as well as the theatre were actively supported by the princess. As a lover of literature and poetry, she knew Thomas Carlyle and Alfred, Lord Tennyson, and was a close friend of John Ruskin, the great writer, artist, and critic. As a result of Alice's influence, many other luminaries from the worlds of music and literature came to stay at Darmstadt. Adept at horsemanship, Princess Alice also took great pleasure in riding, and on mornings when the small rooms of the small house in which they lived seemed even smaller and still more airless, she went riding in the woods around the city not simply to breathe in the fresh air, but to enjoy the sense of space and freedom. Above all, Princess Alice was endowed with a highly developed social conscience, with particular emphasis on welfare and nursing. It was through these activities that she forged strong and inspirational friendships with two equally pioneering Englishwomen, Florence Nightingale and Octavia Hill. Such, then, were the differences between Princess Alice and her husband, differences that in time, though Alice would always love Louis, forced her to face the fact that they shared little in common. In October 1876, 14 years after she had first come to Darmstadt, Alice's undisguised dislike of many of the stiffly correct, petty-minded and malicious inhabitants of her adopted country, together with her fermented frustration at having married a man who was by no means her intellectual equal, and whom she now blamed for being dull and superficial, led her to write bitterly to Louis, "There has never been any lack of love. Only with time the disillusion became hard to bear. I longed for a real companion, for apart from that life, had nothing to offer me in Darmstadt. I could have been quite happy and contented living in a cottage, if I had been able to share my intellectual interests and intellectual aspirations with a husband whose strong, protective love would have guided me around the rocks strewn in my way by my own nature, outward circumstances, and the excesses of my own opinions. I have tried again and again to talk to you about more serious things, when I felt the need to do so, but we never meet each other, we have developed separately, away from each other, and that is why I feel that true companionship is an impossibility for us, because our thoughts will never meet. I shall never forget your great goodness, nor that you are still so fond of me, and I love you too so very much, my darling husband. That is why it is so sad to feel that our life is nevertheless so incomplete, and sometimes so difficult." This would not be the first letter of its kind she would write. In another she accused him of shaking off anything serious or unpleasant, like a poodle shaking off water when it comes out of the sea. But in this particular, and perhaps most passionately important outburst, Alice was not simply berating poor, undeserving Louis for his shortcomings, but blaming him for not being the equal of her adored and much-lamented father. In those halcyon days at the start of their marriage, however, when they were blissfully happy together, when Alice wrote to Louis every day they were apart, and when nothing could intrude upon their own little world and the feelings they had for one another, any sense of disappointment or disillusionment still lay a long way off. 4 months after their marriage, Alice and Louis were back in England on what was to be the first of their prolonged visits to Queen Victoria. The reasons on this occasion were threefold. On the 18th of December, 4 days after the first anniversary of the Prince Consort's death, a service of consecration was held at the Royal Mausoleum at Frogmore, where work had progressed to such an extent that the central part of the structure, inspired by 13th century Italian architecture and decorated with sculpture and paintings in the manner of Raphael, whom Prince Albert had regarded as the greatest painter ever to have lived, was already complete. On that occasion, in the presence of the Prince of Wales, his brothers Arthur and Leopold, the future Duke of Albany and Prince Louis himself, the Prince Consort's remains were interred in a temporary sarcophagus beneath the central dome, soaring 71 feet above. The second reason for Alice and Louis' presence was the marriage, 3 months later, on the 10th of March 1863, of Bertie, the Prince of Wales, and Alexandra, the beautiful elder daughter of the future King Christian IX and Queen Louise of Denmark. Celebrated in St George's Chapel, Windsor Castle, it was to be the first royal wedding at Windsor since Henry I, the widowed son of William the Conqueror, married his second wife, Adeliza of Louvain, in 1122. The third reason for Louis and Alice's visit that spring was still more personal to them, the birth within the castle walls of their first child. Princess Victoria, Alberta, Elizabeth, Matilda of Hesse and by Rhine, future wife of Prince Louis of Battenberg, first Marquess of Milford Haven, mother of Earl Mountbatten of Burma, Queen Louise of Sweden, and Alice, Princess Andrew of Greece, whose son Philip would one day marry Britain's future Queen Elizabeth II, was born in the Lancaster Tower, overlooking the Long Walk on Easter Sunday, 5th of April 1863. In Darmstadt the following day, the birth of the newest member of the Grand Ducal family was announced by a 25-gun salute that resounded over the city. 3 weeks later, Queen Victoria's fourth grandchild, the first to have been born at Windsor, was baptized by the Hessian court chaplain in the presence of a royal gathering that included the infant princess's uncle, Prince Henry, and her great-uncle, Sandro, Prince Alexander of Hesse. After the service, Alexander wrote to his sister Marie, the Empress of Russia, from whom Princess Alice received a splendid bracelet for baby's picture, telling her of the easy way in which their nephew Louis had adopted so many English ways. "He wears a Norfolk jacket, short breeches, and multicoloured garters," he wrote, "is very fond of sherry and horses, reads as little as possible, and never writes at all. He is the Queen's confidant and is popular in England." And so he was, not least because of the interest he showed during visits to the cities of England's industrial north and to several military arsenals and bases. After a short stay with her mother at Osborne, whence the Queen had decamped in early May, Alice, her husband and baby daughter, returned to London to spend a few days with Bertie and Alex, the Prince and Princess of Wales, at Marlborough House, their official residence backing onto the Mall, next door to St James's Palace. No sooner had their bags been unpacked following their arrival from Osborne, however, than Princess Alice received a letter from her mother asking when they would return to England. A note of exasperation may be detected in the Princess's reply when she wrote, "In today's letter you mention again your wish that we should soon be with you again. Out of the 10 months of our married life, 5 have been spent under your roof, so you see how ready we are to be with you. Before next year, Louis does not think we are able to come. At any rate, when we can, we shall, and I hope we shall be able to see you for a day or two in Germany to divide the time." With their return to Darmstadt, the smallness of Alice and Louis' house on the Wilhelminastraße had become less oppressive. This was due entirely to the fact that the Grand Duke, who was not insensitive to the limitations of their accommodation, had put the old castle of Kranichstein at their disposal. Situated a few miles outside the city, the former hunting lodge of the Landgraf of Hesse was set in woodland that was still reserved for hunting wild boar. With its spacious rooms, gardens, woodland and lake, Alice had been immediately captivated by the old house, even though it hadn't been lived in for 80 years. Soon after their return, Grand Duke Louis, as Alice told Queen Victoria, came all the way to Kranichstein to go about with us and see how to arrange it comfortably. "He is most kind and sat an hour with me." It was, for Princess Alice, an idyllic summer, one that she spent playing in the garden with her baby daughter, who, she said, sits up quite strong and looks about and laughs, riding in the woods and swimming in the lake. There were visits to Marburg, Mainz and Freiburg, to Zeeheim and neighbouring Jugendheim to visit Prince Alexander of Hesse, to Mainz at the invitation of Grand Duke Louis, and to other places Alice did not know, such as Kreuznach and Gießen in the north of the country. The size of Kranichstein, where Alice enjoyed a fine dining room and drawing room, meant that she and Louis were now in a better position to entertain formally and informally, to receive deputations of local worthies and politicians, and to entertain family, friends and nobility. As the princess told Queen Victoria, "We give dinners here, which are also useful, as I know so few people." In addition to getting to know the country and its inhabitants, Princess Alice added housekeeping to her list of duties. At Kranichstein, they now had a proper household to account for, a stable to maintain and servants to pay. One addition to the domestic household during the summer of 1863 was a 13-year-old, dark-skinned Malay boy called Willem, who wore a fez, a blue-embroidered zouave jacket and wide trousers, who served at table and sat on the seat behind Princess Alice's pony carriage whenever she drove herself. "He is a dear good boy," wrote the princess, "who was brought over 2 years ago by a gentleman to whom he was given away by his own parents as a mark of gratitude for some service done. This man has had him here 2 years, but has never had him taught anything. He has no religion and can neither read nor write. I am going to have him taught and later christened." Sadly, Alice's hopes for Willem were not fully realized. He died of consumption, tuberculosis, sometime before the end of the decade. Prince Louis, meanwhile, had his own duties of a political, civic, and military nature to occupy him. In June 1863, under the terms of the 1821 Constitution, he took his seat in the first chamber of the Hessian Parliament in Darmstadt, resolutely studied the plethora of state and other papers that were delivered for his attention, received the 3 officers who came to see him on military matters every morning, drilled 2x a week with his cavalry regiment, and was involved with a good many things which would never be expected of him in England, as Princess Alice put it. An early riser, both he and the princess were now up at 6 each morning, Louis kept fit by riding, swimming, walking and rowing. It was at this time, while taking care not to upset the sensibilities of the Hessian bourgeoisie with her radically modern thinking, that Princess Alice started to take an active interest in social matters. Early in 1864, she became a patron of the Heidenreich Stiftung, or Foundation. Its purpose was to help poor but respectable women in childbed by providing whatever material comfort might be necessary, from supplying linen to preparing food. Princess Alice was informed of every case and frequently went in person, albeit incognita, to provide assistance. In early March, for instance, Alice and one of her ladies-in-waiting, Baroness Christa Schenk, visited a family in the old part of town. In a dirty courtyard, the single room in which the woman lived with her unemployed husband, new baby and four other children, all below school age, was accessed by means of a dark ladder. Furnished with three beds and a stove, the room, as Alice reported, did not smell, neither was it dirty. I sent Christa down with the children, then with the husband, cooked something for the woman, arranged her bed a little, took her baby for her, bathed its eyes, for they were so bad, poor little thing, and did odds and ends for her. I went twice. The people did not know me and were so nice, so good and touchingly attached to each other. If one never sees poverty and always lives in that cold circle of court people, one's good feelings dry up, and I felt the want of going about and doing the little good that is in my power. Although it is unlikely she would have realized it quite so soon as she busied herself helping other mothers, Princess Alice was pregnant with her second child. That summer, from May until August, she, Louis and baby Victoria, who at a year old was already speaking her first few words, imitating sounds and even beginning to run unaided, were back in England on yet another visit to Queen Victoria. Despite the fact that very nearly 3 years had passed since the Prince Consort's death, it seemed to her family that she still had a long way to go in overcoming her exaggerated grief. One of the problems was that, while she still wanted to come first in the lives of her children, they were either growing or, indeed, were already grown up, and, as with Alice and Louis, Vicky and Fritz and Bertie and Alex, had young families of their own who now had to come first. Nor were the dark clouds of Victoria's morbid frame of mind much lifted by courtiers such as the Duchess of Buccleuch, who told her they did not know how she could at all get on, or work, or live. The answer to the Queen's need to be number one was found by Princess Alice when she suggested that John Brown, the Prince Consort's favourite, if straight-talking, gilly up at Balmoral, should be brought south to act as Her Majesty's personal attendant. While it would prove a controversial move, leading to family dissent, household difficulties, and scandalous public gossip, it at least took care of the Queen's constant need for attention. She again had a man in the house. For Alice, however, Brown's presence in her mother's life meant that she and Louis were no longer as indispensable as the Queen had thought, and invitations that had once seemed so urgent would now become much less frequent and much less voluntary. Back home in Darmstadt that September, though easily tired by the excessive heat, the by now heavily pregnant princess still went about her daily life, which, as was so often the case, included the comings and goings of members of their extended family. That month it was the turn of Prince Louis's Russian relations. Almost a quarter of a century earlier, in 1841, Louis's Aunt Marie, the only sister of Prince Charles, Grand Duke Louis III, and Prince Alexander, had married the then heir to the Russian throne, Tsarevich Alexander Nikolaevich. In the intervening years, Marie and Alexander, who became Emperor and Empress of Russia in 1855, had had 8 children, 7 sons and 1 daughter. On this particular visit to Hesse, Alexander II brought with him his 2nd and 3rd sons, Alexander, or Sasha, who was destined to succeed his father as Tsar Alexander III, and Vladimir. Princess Alice described these strapping young men, aged 19 and 17, respectively, as very big. Having greeted the emperor and his sons on their arrival in Darmstadt, Alice and Louis were to make up the family party at Jugendheim, where the Empress Marie Alexandrovna, who was slowly dying from tuberculosis, was already staying with her 2nd youngest son, Serge. It was for the benefit of this 7-year-old Grand Duke, who will emerge as a significant player in the story, that the infant Princess Victoria, or Baby as she was still called, would accompany her parents. The reason, as Alice told her mother, was that little Sergei has such a passion for her. Other royalties came and went that autumn, some like Alice's great-uncle Leopold, King of the Belgians, and her sister and brother-in-law, Vicky and Fritz, Crown Prince and Princess of Prussia, were simply passing through and stayed no more than a few hours. Others, most particularly the Prince and Princess of Wales, Alice's beloved brother Bertie and his wife Alex, stayed for a few days. The relaxed, unstuffy atmosphere of his sisters' homes greatly appealed to the prince, especially when compared to all the posturing, stiff formality and militarism associated with the Prussian court. With Louis and Alice, there was no pretension. Of an evening, one of the princess's ladies-in-waiting, Christa Schenk or Marie Grancy, would read aloud or play the piano while Alice painted or sewed. Or if Alice was reading to herself, at this time her favourite books included the Reverend Frederick W. Robertson's Sermons, Lord Malmesbury's Memoirs, and James Froude's 12-volume History of England, Louis would read his paper or fall asleep in front of the fire. As the birth of her second baby approached, her hour of trial, as she called it, Princess Alice, together with Louis, Christa and Marie, took the sacrament in the little church at Kranichstein. Then, as the fine autumn weather she so much enjoyed turned colder, they returned to their house in Bessungen, where Alice spent her time rearranging and tidying out the rooms. It was there, just after 9 o'clock in the morning on the 1st of November 1864, that she gave birth to her second daughter, the occasion heralded once again by a 25-gun salute. At Windsor, later that day, Queen Victoria noted in her journal, "A fine morning, heard just before going out by telegraph from Louis that dear Alice had got a second daughter and that both were doing well. Very thankful, as had felt rather anxious about her, but am sorry it is again a girl. Drove in the little pony carriage with Arthur, her 14-year-old son, and went to the beloved mausoleum where I prayed for dear Alice and the baby and that her dear father's blessing might rest on them." Alice and Louis's own disappointment that their new baby was not a boy was but momentary, as the princess wrote to her mother, adding, "We console ourselves with the idea that the little pair will look very pretty together." A year later, Alice returned to the subject, telling the Queen that her two daughters are so fond of each other and so dear together that they give us much pleasure. I would not change them for boys if I could. Having named their firstborn Victoria, after her maternal grandmother, the new baby girl was to be named in honour of two Elizabeths. Her paternal grandmother, Princess Charles, who, said Alice, had been kindness itself all along. And even more presciently, in view of what was to befall her in later life, the family's 13th-century Hungarian-born ancestress, St Elizabeth, whose grave Alice had visited in Marburg 15 months before. The foundress of both the Hessian and Saxon royal houses, legends of St Elizabeth were popular in Germany. Daughter of the King of Hungary, she was 13 when, in 1220, she married Ludwig, Landgraf of Thuringia. One legend tells how the young Princess Elizabeth, caught between love for her husband and an equally strong desire to help the poor and needy, came upon a leper outside the castle walls. Taking him in, she fed and bathed him. Then, so that he might rest, Elizabeth put him in her marital bed. When he returned, her infuriated husband rushed to the chamber and pulled back the bedclothes. Instead of the leper, he found, as if by a miracle, an image of the crucified Christ. Another version of the St. Elizabeth legend, one the baby who was now named after her would enact as part of a tableau vivant at a family gathering some 30 years later, has it that Elizabeth met her husband while she was on her way to take food to the poor. Asking what she carried in her basket, the princess replied, "Only roses, my lord." When a doubting Prince Ludwig opened it, the food had indeed been miraculously transformed. Yet again, as if to presage events to come in the life of Princess Alice's new baby daughter, the story of her saintly forebear tells how, after the death of Ludwig of Thuringia while on crusade in 1227, his 20-year-old widow refused to eat any food that had been taken from the peasants of land seized as a consequence of war. Banished from court by her husband's incredulous family, Elizabeth went to live in the castle at Marburg, where, having given away her worldly goods to the poor and sick, she entered the Order of St. Francis. Although in failing health, she spent the last 4 years of her life undertaking works of charity. Soon after the birth of her daughter, Princess Alice was back on her feet, looking and feeling strong and well. Her great darling, of a fat baby as she described her, was also doing perfectly, so much so that, as her mother noted, she measured 23.5 inches 2 weeks after her birth, whereas her elder sister, at the same tender age, had measured only 20 inches. At her christening on the 28th of November, the infant princess, whose godparents or sponsors, as they were known, included her grandmother, Princess Charles, her great-uncle, Tsar Alexander II, her aunts Alex, Princess of Wales, Lenkin, her mother's sister Helena, and Anna of Mecklenburg-Schwerin, together with her uncles Affi, Prince Alfred, and Fritz, Crown Prince of Prussia, received the names Elizabeth, Alexandra, Louise, Alice. To her family, she would be known simply as Ella. At Windsor, 19 months earlier, Princess Alice had engaged a young Irish peasant girl as wet nurse for Victoria, but in a departure from established tradition, she now decided to breastfeed Ella herself. The news outraged her mother, the Queen, whose 9 children had all been weaned by wet nurses. Likening what she regarded as Alice's unladylike behaviour to that of a cow, Queen Victoria underlined her displeasure by naming one of her heifers at Balmoral after her daughter. Alice was undeterred, and in fact breastfeeding her baby awakened in her a very real interest in the workings and functions of the human body. It was something she realised would not appeal to everyone, her mother included, but it was a subject she read about, studied, and even attended lectures on. "Instead of finding it disgusting," she wrote, "it only fills me with admiration to see how wonderfully we are made." At the same time, Princess Alice became increasingly interested in all aspects of childcare. Another avenue for her pioneering involvement in social and welfare issues. It was something with which, as a direct result of her mother's influence, Ella would also become identified in the fullness of time. At the start of the new year, 1865, Alice and Louis took their newest daughter on her first journey, a 3-week visit to Vicky and Fritz in Berlin. Travelling by train, Ella had her bath as a bed, while Victoria slept in her bassinet, newly done up with chintz. There was a stove to heat the compartment against the winter weather, which Alice hoped would be sufficient to keep her babies warm on the long journey. If, however, they escaped catching cold, as Alice feared they might just then, neither of the infant princesses was so fortunate once they were back at home in Darmstadt. There, not only was the house very cold, but the snow was so deep that travel by carriage was impossible. Indeed, Alice and Louis could get around only by a sledge drawn by 4 horses. With an outbreak of smallpox in the capital, Alice was worried by the fact that Ella's vaccination had not taken. Victoria was teething, which made her pale and poorly, and both children then went down with severe colds and violent coughs. By mid-June, Ella, at 7 months old, was weaned, had 2 teeth, and was already crawling. A strong, forward and merry child, she was even beginning to speak, or at least knew Papa and Mama and her own name. With her dark blue eyes and rich brown hair, she was the complete opposite of Victoria, who was pale, fair and thin, but who was nevertheless very wild and speaks more German than English. Such was the contrast between her daughters, said Princess Alice, that they would never be taken for sisters. By the following spring, Ella's physical development was such that she was already wearing the dresses her sister had worn the previous year. She had also come on well in the way she reacted to other people, or at least, as her mother informed Queen Victoria, Ella was civil to all strangers, excepting to my mother-in-law or to old ladies. It is too tiresome. Another significant development during the spring of 1866 was Alice and Louis's long-awaited move that March from their small house on the Wilhelminastraße to the recently completed Neues Palais, or New Palace, nearby. Although it was eventually sold in 1943 after the death of the last Grand Duke and destroyed in wartime bombing the following year, the palace stood near one of Darmstadt's surviving and most distinguished landmarks, St. Ludwig's Church, built 40 years earlier in imitation of the Pantheon in Rome and complete with a 33-metre-wide dome. In a garden setting fenced by iron railings and screened by trees, the Neues Palais, although by general consensus out of place where it stood, was no less solid or imposing. Seen from the street, the massive 5-storey structure, with rows of tall arched windows and numerous square chimneys piercing the sloping tiled roofs, might have been any London or provincial railway terminus hotel. From its immaculate park-like rear garden, laid out in clean, geometric lines, burgeoning with a myriad trees, neatly trimmed shrubs, flower beds, and velvet smooth lawns, however, the house looked very different. With its distinctive bow-fronted centre, graceful terrace, balustraded parterre, and double stone staircase, it had about it something of Osborne, which was perhaps hardly surprising. Inside, the rooms were light, spacious, and in true Victorian style, very well furnished. On the walls of every room, among the galleries of pictures, hung paintings, portraits, and lithographs of Queen Victoria, the Prince Consort, and the Duchess of Kent. To these, although Princess Alice claimed not to like them, were added formal state portraits of her great-grandparents, King George III and Queen Charlotte, and her great-uncle, King George IV, which had belonged to the latter George's sister, Princess Elisabeth, Landgravine of Hesse-Homburg. Throughout the house, colourful chintzes dressed the windows and covered the furniture. All but replicating the homes she had known in England, Princess Alice, by now pregnant with her third child, whose birth was expected in July, was so delighted with the effect that she enthused, "I can hardly fancy we are in Germany, the house and all its arrangements being so English." No sooner had they moved into their new home, which had been expensive to build and would before long prove extremely expensive to run, than Alice and Louis's happiness was overshadowed when conflict over the Baltic duchies of Schleswig and Holstein, hereditary possessions of the Danish crown, which had been occupied by Prussia and Austria since 1864, led to civil war. An issue of considerable complexity, the origins of which went back to the First Schleswig War of 1848-50, it had been said by the British Prime Minister, Lord Palmerston, that there were only three people who understood the causes: the Prince Consort, who was dead, a German professor who had gone mad, and himself, who had forgotten what it was all about. When it broke out in June 1866, part of the reason for what became known as the Seven Weeks' War was that Bismarck, Prussia's Iron Chancellor, who dreamt of creating a greater Germany and who was set on a policy of annexation, wanted the port of Kiel, at that point just out of his grasp. The Prussian claim to the port was that, as the population was mostly German-speaking, the duchies should be ruled from Berlin. Denmark's new king, Christian IX, father of the Princess of Wales, whose marriage to the heir to the British throne and the dynastic link it provided had annoyed Bismarck, claimed that the duchies were indisputably Danish, while Duke Frederick of Augustenberg was adamant that his claim was just as legitimate as the other two. Seizing the opportunity, Bismarck also chose this as the moment to challenge Austria, with whom Prussia had already been bickering about the administration of the Danish duchies, for political supremacy over all the Germanic states. War, said an anxious Princess Alice, would be too fearful a thing to contemplate. Brother against brother, friend against friend. She was right, with the royal family already divided, Queen Victoria in favour of the Prussians, Bertie and Alexandra naturally on the side of the Danes, any hostility would indeed pit brother against brother. The loyalties of Prince Louis and, need it even be said, his uncles Grand Duke Louis and Prince Alexander, lay with Hesse, while those of his younger sibling, Prince Henry, were with Prussia, in whose army he was carving a career for himself. When the time came and the Hessian army marched off, with Prince Louis in the vanguard commanding the cavalry and riding a horse that Queen Victoria had given to him, it did so to fight against the Prussians, the wrong side, as it would turn out. Then in June, as the Prussian armies crossed the Hessian frontier, Princess Alice packed Victoria and Ella off to England and the protective wing of their grandmama at Windsor. On the 11th of July, in the midst of a heatwave and endless conflicting reports and rumours about the progress of the war, Alice gave birth to her third daughter, a strong, healthy girl with dark eyes and brown hair. Soon enough, the Hessian armies were crushed by the greater might of the supremely well-equipped, well-drilled, and well-commanded Prussians. Hesse Castle was overrun, and huge numbers of casualties poured into Darmstadt. When Prussian troops entered Frankfurt, Princess Alice begged Grand Duke Louis to accept whatever punitive terms Bismarck might offer if it meant avoiding further bloodshed. It was something for which Prince Alexander never forgave her. These foreigners who wanted to barter the country to Prussia and cherish the incredible illusion that the King of Prussia may prove generous to Hesse, he wrote in disgust to his sister, the Empress Marie. As it turned out, it was the Emperor of Russia, Alexander II, who came to the Grand Duchy's assistance. For while the Prussians still marched into Darmstadt with all the bravado of occupying forces, their bands playing and making as great a demonstration as they could, as Princess Alice told her mother, the Russian Tsar had telegraphed the King of Prussia, warning him that any attempt to seize his brother-in-law's realm would be met by Russia declaring war on his country. In the event, although Homburg and Frankfurt were taken and reparation to the tune of 3 million florins demanded, Hesse and by Rhine retained its sovereignty under the rule of Grand Duke Louis III. As peace was declared and an armistice signed, gallant Prince Louis, together with his horse, returned unharmed.
Also reunited with their parents were the toddler Princesses Ella and Victoria, who had left Windsor Castle for home on the 23rd of August.
Took leave with much regret of darling little Victoria and Ella, who were such little loves, Queen Victoria noted in her journal that day. They have been quite like my own during these 2 months, and are really two as handsome, clever, and engaging children as it is possible to see. She had also referred to little Ella, who was not quite 2 years old, as obstinate and peevish, but a splendid child. The effect of being parted from their mother and their obvious inability to understand why it had happened had less of an effect on Victoria, who even at the age of 3 and a half appeared to have taken it all in her stride, than it did on her younger sister. Now back with her mother, Ella clung on to Alice whenever she came into the room. She keeps kissing me and putting her fat arms around my neck, the princess, who, unlike most other royal mothers, always spent a good deal of time with her children, wrote home. There is such a scene when I go away. She is so affectionate. On the 11th of September, the day before Prince Louis's 29th birthday, his and Alice's new baby was christened. In a ceremony at which her father's entire regiment, the Hessian Cavalry Brigade, stood as godfather, the 8-week-old princess was given the name Irena, the Greek word for peace. It was, said Princess Alice, a name my parents-in-law and we like. It stands, besides, as a sort of recollection of the peace so longed for. It will always remind us of how much we have to be grateful for. 2. With the Noyes Palais up and running, Princess Alice had of necessity to keep an eye on the family finances. Although they were not as stretched at this point as they would soon become, Alice had already recognized the need for thrift.
Even before the outbreak of war that spring, she had made all the walking-out summer dresses for herself and her children, and in addition, as she confided to her mother,
all the nursery accounts and everything myself, which gives me plenty to do, as everything increases and on account of the house, we must live very economically for the next years. Helping to pay the price for opposing Prussia in the 7 weeks' war also imposed its own financial demands, which used up the last of Princess Alice's dowry. As the effects of the conflict continued to be felt, the princess's regular visits to the wounded and sick stirred in her an almost obsessive need to do more to help. Already actively involved with the Heidenreich Foundation for Poor Mothers, she undertook to raise funds for another necessary institution. This came about as a result of Alice having attended a series of lectures about the mentally ill and the need for asylums. Of her own volition, she now became the driving force behind the establishment of such a home. To find the necessary money, she held a 4-day bazaar at the Noyes Palais, which attracted vast numbers of visitors. Curiosity, rather than altruism, drew a great many. A royal home open to the public, with the prince and princess lending a hand in person, was a unique experience. It was for that very reason that Alice decided that it was not something she intended to repeat. A one-off event was one thing, but neither she, her family, nor their home would again be looked upon as objects at an exhibition. Nevertheless, the bazaar achieved the desired result, and in raising the necessary funds, the event was a bigger success than Alice had dared hoped for. 2 years later, on the 15th of October 1869, she was present when the asylum, the first of its kind in Darmstadt, was formally opened. In common with many of her adopted countrymen and women, the stress and anxiety of war had not left Princess Alice herself unscathed. Although she was still a young woman, she was already prone to rheumatism, and from now on, although part of her trouble was doubtless a psychological response to the lack of any real intellectual stimulation, she also began to suffer increasingly from neuralgia, severe headaches, eye strain and tiredness, which would before long give way to exhaustion and an increasing need to rest. Undeterred by her own physical discomforts, Alice's thoughts remained firmly focused on establishing a welfare system in a country where, until now, such a thing had been non-existent. It was towards the end of 1866 that, influenced by like organizations in Baden, Bavaria, and Prussia, Princess Alice looked at founding a women's guild or union across the country. Each of its branches would come under the control of a local committee, while Alice herself, helped by her mother-in-law, Princess Charles, six other volunteers and four doctors, would, as president, head the body's central committee in Darmstadt. It was, she admitted, no small undertaking. Known as the Alice Frauenverein, the union was dedicated to very specific purposes. Put simply, in peacetime it was to be responsible for recruiting, educating and training nurses who, at times of war or at any other national emergency, would be equipped to work in hospitals, distribute and direct supplies where most needed, and care for the poor, always one of Alice's major concerns. Soon after it was set up, the Alice Frauenverein, which existed for 60 years until it was finally merged with the Red Cross in 1937, consisted of active, qualified nursing members as well as auxiliary or non-nursing volunteers. Another activity of the Guild was the welfare of destitute orphans. Rather than house them within institutional orphanages, it was Princess Alice's suggestion that they be found homes with the families of respectable working people and their keep paid for from civic funds. In the course of the next few years, Princess Alice's philanthropy also embraced the growing movement of women's rights, whose conference she attended in Darmstadt, the improvement, education and paid employment of poor unmarried women and girls, and the question of decent housing for the underprivileged, including the novel provision of proper sanitation. In this she was very much of a mind with her friend and close contemporary, the English social reformer Octavia Hill, who in 1865, as Alice saw for herself when on a visit to London, had started her own programme of housing management by acquiring properties for the rehabilitation of poor families. In time, Octavia Hill found herself managing no fewer than 6,000 properties, and by example, her teachings spread from Britain to America and throughout Europe. An Octavia Hill Verein was even established in Berlin. In Darmstadt today, perhaps the most conspicuous aspect of Princess Alice's own efforts at welfare reform and the greatest part of her legacy is to be found in the state-of-the-art Alice Hospital on Die Burgerstraße, not far from the centre of town. While the earliest of Alice's hospitals was located in the neighbouring Mauerstraße, the establishment of a proper hospital was a further manifestation of the princess's determination to work in the interests of the sick and needy. For her, as her grandson, Prince Ludwig of Hesse, would one day say, the point of departure always remained a human being who was ill and needed help. Florence Nightingale, whose counsel had been sought when the Alice Frauenverein had been set up, had also been a guiding light in the establishment of the original Alice Hospital. Even, as it would transpire, to the extent that its first matron, Charlotte Helmsdorfer, had spent the most significant part of her own nursing training at the Florence Nightingale School at St Thomas's Hospital on the opposite bank of the Thames to the Houses of Parliament in London. Of all Princess Alice's children, only Ella would come to mirror her mother's very considerable achievements in her work among the poor and the sick, and exemplify her pioneering spirit and vision, her liberalism and liberality. At this time, however, she, like her sisters Victoria and Irena, the three Graces as they were called, was still a child in the nursery at the Neues Palais, looked after by their redoubtable and greatly loved nurse. Known to her charges as Orchy, Mrs. Mary Ann Orchard, whose praises Princess Alice could not sing highly enough, joined the family early in 1867. Such order she keeps, Alice crowed happily, besides understanding so much about the management of the children's health and character. By the end of the following year, Orchy and her two nursery maids, a young German called Katrinchen and an English girl, Emma Bailey, had a fourth baby to mind in the upper floor nursery overlooking the garden. On the 28th of November 1868, the guns had again boomed out over Darmstadt in salute. This time, though, they didn't stop at 25, as they had before, but went on firing in proclamation of the birth of a son to Louis and Alice, His Grand Ducal Highness, Prince Ernst Ludwig Albert Karl Wilhelm, or Ernie, as he would always be known to his family. On the 7th of October 1870, the celebration was repeated when, although it was not an easy birth, Princess Alice produced her second son, a fat and healthy boy for whom she and Louis chose the names Friedrich Wilhelm August Victor Leopold Ludwig. Known to his mother as Fritti, and frequently to his brother and sisters as Fritz or Fritzi, the little prince would induce.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.